All right, we are live. We're just going to give everyone a couple of minutes to join before we begin. Right, we see people are starting to join on. Sister Balbina, I think we lost your camera. All right, awesome. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Jazakallah khair for joining us for week two of Mondays with Muhsen. Today, we are very happy to have with us Shaykh Noman Hussain. Shaykh Noman Hussain was born and raised in the Chicagoland area. He began his pursuit of knowledge locally, and by the age of 11, he completed the memorization of the Quran. To further his learning in the Islamic sciences, Shaykh Noman traveled to South Africa, where he graduated from the Islamic University of Johannesburg, South Africa. He earned ijazah in several Islamic sciences. Currently, Shaykh Noman serves as the imam and resident scholar at the Islamic Society of Milwaukee in Brookfield, Wisconsin. He is also a high school instructor at Salam School in Wisconsin, and he is particularly active in interfaith initiatives, youth engagement, and community outreach. He resides in Wauwatosa, Wisconsin with his wife and four children. So take it away, Shaykh Noman. Thank you so much for being here with us. And to everyone listening, if you enjoy this program, please do support Muhsen in the link in the description.
Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Everybody for tuning in. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd. I'm going to start our session off by reciting a few verses from the Quran pertaining to the month of Ramadan, inshallah, and then we'll get into our conversation and our discussion for today.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون أياما معدودات فمن كان منكم مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر وعلى الذين يطيقونه فدية طعام مسكين فمن تطوع خيرا فهو خير له وَأَن تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنُ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي لعلهم يرشدون صدق الله العظيم.
So, Bismillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses where he talks about the month of Ramadan, Allah says that this is a month in which the beautiful Quran was revealed. This is a month where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given the honor of prophethood. This is where it all began for us. This is where our story begins. The month of Ramadan with the revelation of the Quran on the beautiful night of power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us human beings with the greatest word and with the guidance from the Almighty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about this month, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions something interesting. Now, a lot of us, when we look at the month of Ramadan, generally it's, you know, we think of hardship. We think of difficulties. Why? Because, you know, as much as it's a time for forgiveness and mercy and prayers and du'as, there's a lot of striving. We got to stay away from food and drink. We have to stay awake at night praying. Our schedules change. You know, we become tired and groggy. There's so much that happens in the month of Ramadan. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the essence of Ramadan is not to make life difficult for you. The purpose of Ramadan is not to make life difficult for you. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I desire ease for you. Ramadan comes, it's the month of the Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I desire ease for you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. And I don't want difficulty and challenges for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants ease and comfort for us. So in something that seems to be difficult, in something that we may perceive to be a challenge, Allah is saying that in reality, it's not meant to be a challenge. It's meant to be a mercy for you. It's meant to be ease for you. It's not meant to be a difficulty for you. So a lot of times I reflect over this, and I think about the challenges that we all face in life, the different challenges that we experience in life, whether it be the challenge of health, or it be the challenge of wealth, or just sickness, or any type of condition that we're experiencing in life, the loss of a child, the loss of a loved one, a difficult marriage, difficult relationships, all of these things that we experience, we look back at this ayah, and we think to ourselves that although there is, difficulty that we see within those challenges that we face, in reality, they're meant to be a source of ease and comfort and forgiveness for us. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's a very beautiful hadith, and I want to tie this into talking about what Muhsen is about and why Muhsen is such an important organization in all of our lives, right? It's literally something that we need for us to have a community of compassion, a community of inclusivity, a community of empathy. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, and this is somewhat related to the month of Ramadan as well. You know, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he says that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "O Prophet of Allah, who is the dearest human being to the Almighty? Who is the most beloved and dearest human being to Allah?" So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looks at this man, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that the dearest person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that brings the most benefit to people. The dearest and the closest to Allah, the Prophet didn't say is one who prays the Tahajjud all night, isn't one who reads the entire Quran every day, isn't one who prays 20 rak'ahs of tarawih, isn't one who makes i'tikaf for 30 days in the masjid, isn't one who gives all of his wealth, right, for the sake of Islam necessarily. The Prophet in this hadith here is saying that the dearest and most beloved to Allah is one who brings the most benefit to mankind and to people. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes on to say, and the dearest deed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one that brings most joy to people. To bring joy to a Muslim, to bring joy to a believer, to bring joy to a human being is the most beloved deed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or relieving him of some distress, or paying off a debt for that believer or for that human being, right? Paying off a debt for someone is a huge, huge reward. It's an amazing benefit in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and holds great rewards in the hereafter. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, or dispelling or getting rid of the hunger of a fellow human being is one of the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the next part of the hadith is very powerful, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that to walk with a brother or a sister, a fellow believer, a fellow human being, to help fulfill their need, to help fulfill some type of need of theirs, is more beloved to me than making i'tikaf in this masjid of mine, referring to Masjid Nabawi, where our prayers are multiplied 50,000 times. He says, it is more beloved that I walk with my brother or my sister and that I help fulfill their need than spending one entire month in i'tikaf in this masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have a habit of every Ramadan making i'tikaf in the masjid. And in some Ramadans, a Prophet spent 20 days in i'tikaf, 20 days in the masjid, in seclusion, right? And so when we look at this hadith, we realize, subhanAllah, you know, all of these things that we do, when we look at our tradition, at the center of our tradition, at the core of our tradition, we find that it all comes down to helping and assisting and being there for one another. That's what our tradition teaches us. That is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us about over and over again. So when we think about challenges in our life, this time has been an extremely challenging time for all of us. You know, I have been reflecting over this idea for the last month. Since the stay-at-home order, this is something that I've been reflecting over and sharing with my community and with those who I've been able to speak to. There are many people in our community that already have felt before this stay-at-home order a sense of isolation and seclusion. Those include our brothers and sisters who may have family members with special needs. This also includes our brothers and sisters who may be new Muslims or converts. A lot of times they don't have a welcoming feeling when they come to the masjid. They may not feel a sense of community, even though they've accepted Islam, even though a person may be Muslim and may be part of the Muslim community, but because they have a child or a parent, or they themselves are someone who has a special need, they feel a disconnect. They feel that they're isolated, that they feel that they're in seclusion. And so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about challenges and difficulties, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us hope and reminding us that Allah does not want hardship from all of this. Allah doesn't desire to punish you. Allah doesn't desire to make life difficult for you. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make life easy for you. Allah wants to bring ease in your life in this world, even though we don't perceive that ease. But in reality, the challenges that we may face will bring upon ease and forgiveness and mercy for us in this life and also in the hereafter. So when you think about Muhsen and the great work Muhsen is doing, you think about the very tradition, the very sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when you look at the name Muhsen itself, right? This is at the height and the peak of our tradition, having ihsan. Having ihsan with someone means you're a Muhsen. You're showing kindness and grace and love and empathy and mercy to your fellow human beings. And not just your fellow human beings, but those who may be challenged, those who may be facing even more difficulty than the your average Joe or your average human being. The Prophet, it's narrated that Hassan Basri, a very famous scholar, he says that to meet the need of a Muslim is dear to me than praying 1,000 rak'ahs. Praying, helping a brother out, or fulfilling the need of a Muslim brother, this was any Muslim brother, fulfilling their need is dear to me than praying 1,000 units of salah and prayer. This is how our pious predecessors, this is how our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at assisting and helping others. And when you look at this organization, you find that that is at the very core of its mission, to help those that are in need, to help those who may feel disconnected, to help those who may already have been in isolation all their lives. We've had community members, and I speak about my own experience when it comes to special needs. My own father is a, you know, someone with a special need. My own father is deaf and hard of hearing, does not speak and cannot hear. And so when I see that while I am speaking, I have someone who can translate my speech to those who can't hear, is extremely powerful, because this is something that my father would have wished for 20, 30, 40 years ago, maybe even his entire life as he was a deaf person. That having access to the masjid, having access to the khutbahs and the message of the khutbahs, and no matter how beautifully I may be able to recite, the fact that my father can't hear this is something that really, really, you know, I struggle with. But I know that this struggle will allow him to, you know, not only hear me in Jannah, but hear the words of the Quran from the Prophet and the words of the Quran from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Because that is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates our brothers and sisters with special needs. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors them in this life and the hereafter. But another thing that I want to point out here is that not only does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honor those who are, you know, in special needs, you know, there are people who ask this question. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us that a person who is sick and who is unable to pray or is unable to fast, they feel a sense of, you know, a sense of sadness. That how is it possible, like, you know, Allah, you know, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that, you know, Allah loves a person who is sick. How is this love seen, right? I feel bad because when I'm sick, I can't pray or I can't fast. How am I able to, you know, express, or how is Allah expressing love to me in this moment here? So a lot of times we ask this question, we feel bad that we're not able to do what other people are able to do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reminds us, that really when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests a person in a way that they're not able to fulfill certain obligations the way that other people are doing, it doesn't take away at all from any of the reward that they are doing, from any of the reward that they would receive, or the person who is doing it the way that you know, we generally do, it will not take away from any of that reward. And this is what we learn from our beautiful tradition, that this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors our brothers and sisters in this life and honors them in the hereafter as well. So, you know, reflecting just over these thoughts here, I wanted to share with you all that even our own community, even in our own Brookfield, Wisconsin community, we've seen through the efforts of Muhsen so much changing, so much happening, that now we have been able to engage an entire group of people, an entire community that we were not in touch with, that we were disconnected from. And we were really excited actually this year that we were planning to start our first special needs weekend program in the state of Wisconsin and in Milwaukee. And this is something that we feel as a great honor, that I wish that this could have come earlier, but we're here now. And we hope that all of these circumstances that we are in is lifted from us so that we can actually come and gather once again, and we can continue to provide services for those who may need the services that have not been provided for so many years of their lives. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes us, all of us, at the forefront of this cause, because this is the cause, and I can say this with conviction. I can say this with conviction, that if my Habib, if my Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive today, my Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be on the front lines of this effort of Muhsen. My Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have been on the front lines of making sure that every masjid was accessible. My Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be at the front lines to make sure that every human being had access to Islamic knowledge, that every human being felt welcomed and felt that they had a place in the masjid, because it is he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who says that al-masjidu baytu kulli taqi, that the masjid is the house of every believer. It is the home of every believer, whether they are male or female, whether they are abled or disabled. Every human being, every Muslim, their home and their address is the masjid. And so I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes me amongst those who continues to stand in support of those who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has supported and would have supported if he was alive today. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes and grants all of us tawfiq, that we are those who contribute, who can help, who can support financially through your du'as, through your volunteering hours, through your suggestions and your comments and your likes and your shares, that we are all able to be a part of this great, unique effort. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he truly reward all of our brothers and sisters who are behind the scenes taking care of this amazing organization. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he accepts from all of us. Jazakumullahu khairan. I wish all of you a Ramadan Mubarak, a blessed Ramadan. All of us are at home. All of us are spending it with our families. This only adds to the beauty and inshallah to the uniqueness of this particular month of Ramadan in this particular year. It is a Ramadan to remember. It is going to be a Ramadan for the books. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are able to take advantage of this opportunity. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullahu khairan again to the Muhsen team for inviting me on and for the opportunity to interact with you all. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this a beneficial gathering, and that you are able to, inshallah, take away some points from this session, and inshallah, be those that will, inshallah, take advantage of this month. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullahu khairan.
JazakAllah khair, Shaykh Noman, for those beautiful reminders. And we really, really appreciate you speaking on behalf of this population and being such a strong advocate for all of us at Muhsen. So thank you so much. Thanks everyone for tuning in. Thank you to Sister Balbina for the interpreting. We really appreciate that, and it adds a lot of value. So thank you all. And please do remember to support Muhsen, and the link is in the post. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum as-salam. JazakAllah khairan.